evening, everybody. Today's speaker, Mr. Ramu Ramanathan, and today's chairperson, Ms. Jaya Kanodia. May I request them to have a seat, please? Thank you. Twenty years ago, in the name of Gulestan, Rustom Billimoria. Seeing her interest and commitment to the excellence in education, the government those days appointed her on the examination board for the matriculation examination in the subject of English. In 1928, she was a delegate from Bombay at the All India Women's Conference on Educational Reforms. In the same year, she was presided also at the Indian Musical Conference. Next year, she travelled to Geneva as a delegate at the conference of the International Federation of University Women. She was very much acclaimed for her work titled The Constitution, Function and Finance of the Indian Municipality and Government of India. She was really loving education, trying hard to get so many people to be educated, and it was her lifelong activity. Towards this end, she played an active role in the management of various educational, social and charitable institutions such as the Ratan Tata Institute, the Indian Red Cross, the Women Workers Union, the Bharat Scouts and Boys, and the Maharashtra State Women's Council. She was elected a fellow of Bombay University, a syndic, and a member of the Academic Council of the University. Recognizing her outstanding abilities, she was appointed Sheriff of Bombay in 1957, as well as Chief Executive Magistrate. She was also the Secretary of the Subcommittee on Female Education of the National Planning Commission. In recognition of her immense contribution to education and social work, she was awarded the Padma Shri, and then in 1972, the Padma Bhushan also was conferred on her. Hers was a life dedicated to education and social work. Now, in the name of this Gulestan Rustom Billimoria, this endowment was established, and we are trying to get people who will be just like that, having multifaceted personality and speaking about art, culture, history, etc. Now today's speaker, Mr. Ramu Ramanathan, is not a new person to us in the Asiatic. Recently, last month, we had a program on Vinda Karandikar, where he had conducted the whole program very beautifully and in a scholarly manner. He really is a Mumbai-based journalist and playwright and a poet too. His book, Third, that is Sakina Manzil and Other Plays, is a collection of 8 Indian plays in English published by Orient Press. Recently, his collection of poems has been published, namely My Encounters with a People. His list of plays includes Autumn 56, Polyester 84, and his hearts in Comrade Kumbhakarna, and Postcards from Dharoni, which have been staged in India and overseas. I remember that almost 15 to 17 years back, I had witnessed a performance Jaimini Fata, which was written by him, directed by him, and the shows for this play have been all over the world, almost 400 plus. His other plays include Shanti Shanti, It's a War. This got 1993 All India Best Play Award. And Madhav Bhai, as just now I mentioned, Collaborators was performed on BBC Radio Playwright Regional Award also it was got. He is an editor, Print Week India, and has been associated with the printing industry for 30 years. He paints a regular column in Mumbai Mirror, and this profiles the unsung heroes of Mumbai. Recently, another award also was achieved by him for the performing arts category for writing plays. So I hope that we are doing justice with the theme of Gulestan Billimoria, having a multifaceted personality to deliver a speech. Same way, today chairperson, Professor Jaya Panoria, she also, though I think for the first time she has been to Asiatic, but she is a recently course director, deputy course director, Indian Aesthetics, Nyan Prabha. She is having interest as fine artist and academics also, both equally well. She is close to completing a PhD in the Department of English, University of Mumbai. And just guess, she is doing her PhD on Ramu Ramanathan's poems. She has interest in the area of drama and performance study, and literature, theatre and performance as well. Mainly she is attracted towards the transcription or the difference between a performance and a script. So her PhD thesis title also is Drama to Script and Theatre to Performance. Recently she had presented many papers, but I just like that. While teaching in Sophia College as the English professor or doing all this academic work, she was interested in art also, art theory and critical theory as a student of University of Mumbai. She has held exhibitions of her art since 1996 and gained international exposure at the Abrams Clapham Gallery, California, where her work has been displayed since February 2017. Her recent art practice is a return to drawing in pen and ink, while her academic focus has turned sharply towards performance studies and drama. So, having different interest in academics as well as her pursuit. So I welcome both the speaker and the chairperson and request our president to just greet them with a small memento from Asia.
And having sort of that as the measure, everything else pales into sort of comparison. And since Meena Bhai was kind enough to mention Mahadev Bhai, a lot of Mahadev Bhai is of course thanks to Kinnari, but also a lot of it is thanks to Nalini Pandit. I recall two things. One is a little palimpsest that she had produced on Gandhiji, which was my reference for Mahadev Bhai, and of course two to three fairly long conversations with Nalini ji over a period of time. So thank you very much, and thank you very much to friends at Asiatic Society for having me. I'll just, without much ado, get on. So I have some supporting slides. The only caveat that I have is the title is Four Plays and a City, and for reasons of time and constraints of time, I've confined it to a large extent to my work simply because I didn't have the maybe about a year to research on a whole lot of other plays. I do refer to some of them because I'm fond of them, but there are notable gaps, and probably this is the start of something bigger. Today is a special day, so I'll start off with another guru, Samuel Beckett. That's his grave in Paris. And today is 22nd December 2017. And I recall 22nd December 1989. Know it. We had a show of Samuel Beckett's Scraps last tape on the terrace with a garden. This was Sakina Mansion in Colaba. Fittingly and appropriately for a Beckett play, there was no one in the audience, just Meher Pestanji and one fern plant. The house belonged to Meher, and it was a theatre adda. You asked her, you wanted to perform a piece, and she said, you invited her artist friends and comrades and bohemians, some of whom were high and mighty folks, not that we knew, not that we cared. For us, Beckett mattered then, Beckett matters now, he always does, simply because good taste in theatre is extremely important. After William Shakespeare, Bertolt Brecht, Henrik Ibsen, Anton Chekhov, Waiting for Godot is perhaps among the 10 most performed plays in this city. It has been played on a stage, on a ship, in pubs and discos, in classrooms and bastis, at the IIT campus, in a children's park, and so on. One of my favorite shows of this play has been at the Bowen Methodist Church in Colaba, right around the corner. Nasiruddin Shah and Benjamin Gilani blended their Blackbeard and Estrogen with ecclesiastical theology. Samuel Beckett would have loved it. That is his grave, and whenever we are in Paris, it's a small little ritual that we do when we stand in front of this grave and recite lines from his play. And there are two things you must know. One is that any play that I've written, I always plagiarize one line from Beckett. It's considered for me like my lucky mascot. And Crab's Last Tape is a play that I know completely from start to finish by heart. Otherwise, I'm terrified of other playwrights' words. So as I start, I'll sort of say hello to the grand old man. And these are the final lines of Crab's Last Tape. Perhaps my best years are gone, when there was a chance of happiness, but I wouldn't want them back. Not with the fire in me now, no, I wouldn't want them back. That's Beckett in Crab's Last Tape. And now I begin. So to begin at the beginning is predictable. Every two-paced writer begins at the beginning, from Gurudev Bhas to Gurudev Borje. So let me start at the ending. Since I'm a playwright, and I thought it's befitting that I share a little bit of how I write for those of you who are not familiar with the kind of work I do. Since I'm a playwright, let me share a bit from an unpublished and unperformed play called Skyview, plot number 2. So first the context, it's Mumbai. Skyview plot number 2 is a typical Mumbai apartment block which is located in Wakola, beyond repair, like most buildings in Mumbai. It is privy to the lives of its occupants and three centuries of Mumbai's history. In all this, a man and a woman try to fall in love. And unknown to everyone, the Arabian Sea, which surrounds us from three sides, starts creeping into the city. What I'll do is just to give you a sense in the play. Okay. Just for background, this is a building that talks, and this is again something that I used to visit various buildings and apartment blocks in Mumbai, and I would hear things like pipes gurgling and so on, and I would all lifts moaning and groaning, and staircases creaking, and I would always feel that this is actually the conversation or the words in which buildings talk to each other. And at 12:01 in the night, which is generally when most sort of Bohemian artists are awake, I could hear sort of one apartment block talking to another. This is something that would be there. And so this play originated from that. So I'll read the last few scenes. me, which is the building. It is 25 December. As the year has passed by, I see the pumpkinification of sky view plot number 2. The only certainty is the sky. The sky is my Santa Claus who makes me smile always. Merry Christmas, everybody. End of scene 9, scene 10, also the last of the scenes. Me, which is again the building. 29 December, the birthday of my favorite most Rajesh Khanna. Also the happy wala birthday of the unknown office bearer, who is one of the heroes in this day. It's a day of nothingness at Skyview plot number 2. She rings the doorbell. She and he are seeing each other. He opens the door. She stands on her toes, even though she is not shocked. She says, I have seen Lauren Bacall do it to Humphrey Bogart. She, I have seen it in the movies, Bacall and Bogie. He, I am your bogie man. Me, that's the building. She kisses him on his lips. It's the gentlest peck he has ever received. He, that's gentle, tastes really nice, like kadi patta. She, happy birthday, my love. He, what about him, your husband? She, fuck him. He, oh, okay. She, kiss me. He, here? Mishra may be watching through the keyhole. She, fuck Mishra. He, why would you want to do that with Mishra? Me, the two of them laugh. This is the building. The two of them laugh, there is laughter, for only 2.5 seconds. Me. Then the two of them search for his medicines. He hobbles around the house with a mean swagger, saying, I'm Digambar Samyar. He, the hero, says, watch me, I'm Digambar Samyar da. And she says, I'm Digambar Samyar's sidekick. She says, I'm your sidekick da. Together they find his missing pills, the one he pops for his depression. Thus begins the case of Digambar Samyar, the detective with a law degree and Brahmin prejudices. They draw the curtains, the lights are switched off. She says, I have 3 hours till your husband returns. Yes, till my husband returns. End of scene 10, scene 11, also the last of the scenes. Me, 31st December, last day of the year. In the Basti, this is again the building topic. In the Basti, I hear a bhajan program. The songs are recycled and remixed and regurgitated. That's what the organizer who believes in Swami Satyanarayan demands. It's almost midnight. Dark, dark sky. No 10 o'clock band tonight. The bhajani packs his pai peti. He's very drunk. He says alcohol is the only way he can tolerate such evenings, which are a far cry from the days when he used to utter Sant Gadge Maharaj's sayings or epiphanies to Kalubai on the mountain top. The basti abounds with drunks. The high and mighty at Altamount are drunk. The hills of Mumbai are drunk. But the drunks do not realize that the Arabian Sea has seeped into their city. The rubble has drowned. The cement has sunk. The drains are inundated, all so quietly. Mumbai is in a stupor. And as Bhagirathi Society said before she collapsed, beware Dada Sky View. Remember what Maktoum Faqir Ali Paru had said. What the seas giveth, the seas take it. Next day, Bhagirathi Society collapsed. Just like her great-great-grandfather, the flour mill in Churchgate, who was born in 1725, but drowned in the sea. At that time, Bhagirathi's ancestor said, the Arabian Sea, that's all I see. End of scene 11, scene 12, penultimate scene. Me, it's 32nd December. I had seen nothing like this before. The sea had entered the city. A fish called Matsya tickles my feet. A fish called Matsya had forewarned us about this. But who pays heed to a fish, no? Can you hear the silence? No. No murmuring from the 56 languages and the 118 castes that inhabit these homes. No one raises their voice. Just sea water and all that salt. Skyview plot number 2 is like an island in the city, marooned. Manik stands upright. Manik is a watchman of that particular building. So do he and she, hand in hand. Ashraf's daughter too. These are some of the other characters who inhabit this place. Under the water tank, no one to kiss for the first time in her tiny existence. Ojasnath and Omkar Nath with their wife. She has 6 bags of jalakia, 1 bag for lau khirsa, 1 for khaja, some maka manji chatpati, suji halwa, chatu bara. It's going to be the last supper. Tembe master is on the terrace. He is seated on the water tank. He plays the bhongli, the ceremonial drum of the Bandaris of Mumbai. He says, in Sambat 729, the Angres came from the Vilayat in the favorable month of Jesh to Mumbai. Lisbon gives Mumbai to London as a dowry, and and the engraves prospered in the city of Sindh. Half of Mumbai's islands under the sea at that time. This includes banks and mints and underworld crime. The flyovers, the factories, the flats, the colonies. Look now how the wheel has turned. The Arabian Sea is up to my knees. Silence. The building says, she tells he, she, marry me, he, okay, me. It's sometimes as simple as that. She, no dowry, he, but naturally. Me, that is the building. I want to say I wish the king of Portugal was as wise. She, we sow sins, punishment we reap. He, our sins multiply. Me. The king of Portugal gifted the islands as dowry to King Charles II of England when he married Catherine of Braganza. She, an island we were. He, an island we return to. Me. At Skyview, plot number 2, we see the sea. She watches. She has not forgotten that sinful day on 11 May 1661. End of scene 12, scene 13. The 13th scene at Skyview, plot number 2, me. 33rd December. The Arabian Sea has risen to the 6th floor. I feel the sea water in my cracks. There are no waves. I feel a thud, thud, thud. That is the 100-year-old Gulmohar, all 3 stories of her. She is not alone. 1,72,000 buildings have sunk into this watery grave. Automobiles, autorickshaws, elevators pass by, all muted. Strange as it may seem, not a single human being. It is like a silent film. 20 million Mumbaikars and their city drowned, and not one whimper. Suddenly, 2 Arabian horses float by. They look familiar. These are the 2 horses that Jamshedji Gigi Boys presented to Queen Victoria as a gift. Each horse was worth 30,000 rupees. I feel a burpee belch in my intestines. The Arabian Sea, she has risen to the 7th floor. He and she can now touch the sea. It is icy. The future is uncertain, nothing to say. Everything is quiet. Everything that has been fabricated since 1018 is under the water. From the copper plates of the Tagar ancestry in Thane to the stone inscriptions in the village Utan. Ashraf's daughter says, order lunch from McDonald's now. Tembe master hums Bhim Sen. He says it's the only way to survive. Time ticks, drop by drop. I feel weak. I feel giddy. My pipes have disintegrated, my foundation corroded. How much longer can I stand upright? So much to do, so much to do. I want to set up a committee who can monitor timely repairs that can be carried out on old structures, which would reduce number of dilapidated buildings that are listed before monsoon every year. But not a single brother and sister left, just me and the sky. I sigh one last time. The sky sighs back at me. At Skyview, plot number 2, Tembe master picks up his harmonium. He hums. She hums. He, the unknown office bearer, applies Amritanjan on my back. The sea water rises. I sense my heartbeat stutter. Manik scatters seeds on the floor. Where are the butterflies which visit Skyview, plot number 2? I wheeze. My circulation halts. Just then, he and she spot one butterfly. It is a rare orange and brown red spot. The butterfly lands. Tembe master plays his harmonium. This is the end. No. Freeze tableau, end of scene 13, end of the play, end of Mumbai City. So from that movement, we move on to slightly more cheerful stuff. So 9 reasons why playwrights write plays. I'll just try to do a quick crash course on that. Why 9? Because of the Italian poet whose 15th century manuscript, which is carefully locked somewhere in this building. In the Divine Comedy, Virgil and Dante begin the journey into the underworld or the 9 circles of hell. All playwrights make this journey into the 9 circles of hell. Hell is not other people, hell is us. Playwrights enter, re-enter hell. Their words seek lucidity, but mostly the words lie. As the extraordinary George Bushnell said in Darmstadt in July 1834, whoever speaks the truth on this planet is ultimately hanged. And so truth must be hidden in a safe place. Buchner also says, do not share truth, especially with friends, families, and loved ones. You will suffer. But you can share truth with audiences, as long as you can trust those audiences. However, if you're caught uttering the truth in this day and age, you will be taxed. So there is direct tax. 21%, indirect tax GST 25%, peace of mind tax 15%, insomnia, barbiturates and badmashi tax 4%, taxes for sundry diseases which include poverty 9%, starvation and exploitation tax 6%, paying obeisance to all kinds of fools tax 33%. Plus, nowadays we have Aadhaar. So every single thought in your brain shall be linked to a UIDAI number and taxed. Sans Aadhaar, your persona non grata. Sans Aadhaar, your thoughts are persona non grata. They can be disconnected any moment. These are the nine circles of hell. There are other circles of hell too. So what I've done is I've created a tiny collection of 20 one-liners. Now these are one-liners I've overheard in gents' cloakrooms, in the canteen area of theatres, green rooms and backstage zone after a theatre show. So before we stumble in the general direction of the plays that I'm going to discuss, let me quickly share with you, especially for those of you who don't visit the theatre often enough, you'll get a general sense of the chit-chat and gupshup. So the 20 one-liners. 1. You can understand a lot about theatre if you try to comprehend it. 2. Isn't it a serious sort of comedy? 3. I hate plays that make me think. You tell me, am I supposed to watch the play or am I supposed to think? 4. I decided to direct the play when I read it. If I hadn't read the play, chances are I would not have directed it. A well-known commercial, Gujarati director. 5. I knew I was going to forget that line yaar, so I decided not to learn it. 6. Listen, if you can't imitate Mukta Barve, then don't try to copy her. 7. My only problem with the theatre is the dialogues. Everybody is talking all the time. 8. When a dialogue has double meaning, I don't know in the play to follow. 9. Just when you think you know everything about the theatre after you've attended a theatre seminar, you're informed that Patte Bapu Rao penned 2,40,000 lavanis. Sometimes I feel there's a bit too much of culture going around and I simply can't digest it. 10. No one goes to see Sahi Re Sahi. So Sahi Re Sahi was this huge blockbuster and in all the four languages, and always the day it opened it went sort of box office. So 10. No one goes to see Sahi Re Sahi since it's always houseful. 11. Children's plays are a very good thing because it gets the parents interested in the theatre. 12. Ultimately, every actor toes the line. 13. The lighting was great except for all the darkness. 14. If there were no actors, we would be speechless. 15. You should always go backstage after a show, good, bad, indifferent, and say, only you could have done it. 16. Plays come, plays go, but depths, they always accumulate. 17. A good audience is usually thinking about something else. 18. The grandiloquent lines are magnificent, but I think it's the trifles that make a play. In fact, the truth is, trifles make the sum of life. 19. After a particularly poor show at Prithvi, the aging Tiwari ji, those of you who know him, the aging Tiwari ji at Prithvi Theatre consoled an upcoming star by saying, look into the sky, even the sky is empty. 20. When despondency was at its worst, an actor believed he should die. The question was, should the actor die at home reading Sophocles, or on the road reciting the lines from a Satish Alekar play, or on the stage reveling in John Foster's silence? This brings me to the first of the plays, that's Jazz. So, this was again a play that was 2007-2008, and it was a musical. I'm going to talk straight away about the year 2014, this year. Seated in the St. Peter's Church on Hill Road in Bandra, paying heed to the four-part harmony, I realized that more than hockey, it was music that kindled the Stanislav's membranes. In the good old days, it was an all-male chorus under the baton of Father Irash and Father Alio, and the rich strains of the pipe organ in the choir loft. It was only at that time I realized, but it was the organs belted out classics. The school with government support was plebeian, but the music that we played was snobbish. Many years later, I realized that the church is a place where you can listen to music in the old-fashioned way. Today, with music being heard on the move or on your headphones or Facebook, this community sharing of music is fading away. In a way, when I started writing Jazz, the musical for Denzel Smith and his group State Smith, It was reconnecting with the music from my school days. The research gave me the opportunity to relive the good old days. Writing jazz was easy, since the ode to the contribution of Goan to the bandra that I knew and the bandra that I loved. So the play is basically the story of these two characters, that is the old cynical music composer Goan Christian, who probably did the background scores for people like Sahid Ludhianvi, S.D. Burman, who plays the alto sax. Okay, so that is basically the play. What I'll do is I'll just quickly read a few lines from the production notes because we don't have footage to, so we can show them the next slide well. So these are some of the studio shots of the Grubeck there. You have Chip Chocolate with his group and so on. So the production notes for jazz says, when Hindi film music entered a period of rapid revolution during the Second World War, composers realized that the small groups they previously used could not effectively convey the drama unfolding on screen. So they performed formed large orchestras that ranged from dholaks, sitars, along with bands of violins, swaths of trumpets and Hawaiian guitar or two. Since not many musicians from other communities knew how to play saxophones or clarinets, Goans came to form the bulk of the orchestras. Few trained in the Hindustani classical tradition knew how to compose and score music for the new ensembles. This task was performed by a Goan arranger. Typically, the work was as such: the producer would organize a sitting, as the Goans came to call the baithaks, at which the composer, most often a Hindu, the lyricist, usually an Urdu-speaking Muslim, and the arranger would flop down on comfortable cushions to listen to the director narrate the plot. When the director indicated the point at which the song was necessary, the composer would hum out a melody or pick it out on his harmonium, and just the basic notes, and the rest of the notations were done by the arranger, and basically compose all the background scores and also fill in the bits for the song. The arranger wasn't merely a secretary. As I discovered while researching, the Goans drew on their bicultural heritage to give Bollywood music its promiscuous charm, slipping in slivers of Dixieland stomp, Portuguese fados, Ellingston's doodles, cha-cha-cha, Mozart, Bach themes. So long before fusion music became fashionable, it was being performed every day in Bombay's film studios. So basically, with the Hindustani classical musicians, what happened was they had to memorize the notes, whereas with the Goan Christians, they could follow the Western score and read the notations, and then therefore it became easier. In those days, we didn't have digital, so you don't have to, you should not edit. You had to record these long songs, 10 minutes, 20 minutes at one go. So these people who followed the notations were preferred to the Hindustani classical. So they were known as the Hindustani classical musicians, or the instrumentalists were known as bihatkars, because they used to bihat everything, and these people would follow the score. When I visited the St. Stanislaus School Church on a Sunday, two things happened. I flashbacked in time, and I realized that that church, St. Peter's Church, was built in 1853. The year 1853. Completed the first draft of his Tritiya Ratna, which according to me is one of the most modern plays of our times. Fule penned the words 150 years ago when the seven islands in the city were trying to rise above the seas. The mainland into VT station, carrying the tenets of democracy in its compartments. That's how sanity prevailed in a little city with a fortified fort and a cluster of community homes and the first of the cotton mills. See how the dots have started to connect. In the 1970s, I used to stay in the LIC colony located opposite the Santa Cruz bus depot. In those days, there was no paranoia, and so there was zero security at the bus depot gates. Therefore, a lot of my time was spent playing bat and ball in the bus depot. My cousins in Coimbatore and Chandigarh climbed trees. We climbed double-decker buses. My Ambu Attai, who's dead, said to me on the same day as today, "Do you see the Western Ghats near Coimbatore and the Palakkad Gap? It matches the gap in the central high lines of Madagascar, from which it originated as a result of the volcanic eruptions 88 million years ago. Did you know that?" she asked me. I said, "I did not know." This city's history is much younger. What I did know was life was simple. Mumbai was a city of equals. A lot of my friends were children of Bhandaris and Kolis and Kunbis and Mahars and Mams, and of course, Kamral Iblis. As a child, I accompanied my friends to see a play performed for the LIC Class 4 Union in the community center in the colony. My first serious play was a Loknatya called Ram Nagari by Ram Nagarkar. who was also the Songadia in the super hit Lok Natya Ichhamati Purikara, along with the inscrutable Niru Phule. The play Ramnagari begins Sala Hajjam. It is a roadside altercation, and Ramnagarkar, the son of a barber who is watching the entire episode, wonders, why do people drag our Hajjam profession into their petty fights? That is when I started to realize that in Mumbai, theatre is language. Also, I realized that theatre is everywhere. Even today, there are more than 1500 play performances in a month, even today. Four main languages, Hindi, English, Gujarati and Marathi. You can add Telugu, Kannada, Konkani and Marwari to this list. This beats the monolingual monoculture theatre of New York or London or Berlin hands down. Also, unlike the subsidized art of Delhi or government grants, the top Marathi or Gujarati play nets 2,50,000 at the box office. This is for a single show, all cash, no checks. Box office revenue was 20 crores last year, which depleted to 15 crore after 8 November, and half of that after GST was promulgated in July 2017. So much to say. So let's start in South Central Mumbai, which is just around the corner. This is the area from Khetwadi to Kamatipura, the epicenter of Bombay after the British royalty were gifted the island city by the Portuguese. The first thing to spring up in this city was the theatre. There were 35 makeshift theatres which featured plays performed in English for the recreation of the English, for the recreation of the British soldiers. As the old timers say about the theatres of Mumbai, it had to fulfill three basic conditions. Number one, be close to a tram stop or railway station. Two, be in proximity to a dingy bar. Three, be located in a red light area. Here I must share an anecdote which I heard from Namdev Dasal. I know it well because I heard it thrice. Like all great writers, Namdev Dasal repeated himself. This Namdev Dasal anecdote has its mise en scene in the red light neighborhood area of Falkland Road and the Golpita Chowraha. These days it has the honorific title of Patte Bapurao Mark. Patte Bapurao is the doyen of Tamasha. Besides the 16,000 songs he composed, there is the legend about how he, a novice, participated in a jugalbandi and defeated the opponent, a veteran, in a sawal jawab. By Patte Bapurao's singing and his poetry, the Brahmin Bapurao married this girl. On cue, the theatre performances were banned. But the manager of the Bangwadi Theatre, a Mohammedan, ensured that the show must go on, because the show always goes on. So he got the Brahmin Mahar husband and wife to sit on the stage and charge 2 annas for the ticket. The audience made more money at the box office from a stage wedding than all the plays put together. Namdev Dasal's mantra, a theatre wala must always know how to beat the system. This has always been the truth in Mumbai. I now come to Sakina Manzil. I'm also happy about this play for two reasons. One is, a lot of the research in this play was thanks to two dear friends, Amrit Gangar and Dharam Sibai. And Dharam, where the newspapers were, and basically read about that period between 1944. And I was, of course, looking at the material at that time. The other thing was, I think, the first show of Sakina Manzil on 14th April, which is the day of the dock explosion, transpired at the Asiatic. 40 to 50 people who had actually been a part or had witnessed the dock explosion in 1944. And who was so engrossed and involved with a particular production of the play that it was quite a stirring experience. So as mentioned once before, one thing theatre enables is playing hopscotch with time. It's time to flashback into teen Sakina Manzil territory to 1944. In the sultry days of 1944, when there were no air conditions, there were theatres like Baliwala Grand Theatre called the Pillar House, wherein a play opened with a loud bang of exploding potash while the curtain was being raised. And even as the audience went silent and attentive, occasional shouts from the vendors around the theatre percolated the auditorium. Pista Badam, Chopri, Pankha, Uthav Jaldi, and incessantly extolling of the ticket seller, Khel Abhi Chalu Hua. For some of the performances in the Gothic style theatre like Victoria, Ripon, Baliwala, the drama companies used to bring their own main curtain, which was operated by two men. Since the curtain pullers often dozed off, and usually they were mazdoors, they were not from the theatre company. Since the theatre pullers often dozed off, the cue to bring the curtain down was the shrill blast of a whistle. And basically these were heavy curtains, and they had these huge stones at the bottom, about 8 to 12 of these stones, so that the curtain can come down fast, otherwise the process is very fast. During one of the shows, the curtain pullers who were asleep were awakened by a shrill whistle, and so they hurriedly brought down the curtain in the middle of the scene. And obviously it was a play of about King Lear. King Lear was dead, he was lying on stage and enacting that final death scene. And this poor actor sees these 12 heavy stones coming towards him. So when he sees that, he gets up and runs, and of course the audience finds it hilarious and they boo him. It was only later that it was found out that the whistle was not blown by a prompter, but by a BST traffic conductor on the street. I had used the above scene in Teen Sakina Manzil. I plagiarized from reality and I borrowed from this city. Whether Teen Sakina Manzil rediscovered the magic of theatre, I don't know. Whether the play is a success or not, I don't know. Whether the play was understood or misunderstood, I don't know. For me, what mattered is I had to write the play about the 1944 dock explosion which tore this city apart. There was the ocean and how languages beget other languages. During the research of this play, I met a Kachi businessman from Mandvi. At that time, I was struck by the multiple Kachi dialects being used in the radius of the port area in Mumbai. So there was Bhatia Kachi, Memini Kachi, Hoja Kachi, Lohana Kachi, Baniya Kachi, and so on. Each with Kachi. Then there were the Maplas, the Jews, the Nagoris, the Marathas, the Mahars, the Marthadis, the Kumbis. That is when I started to realize that in Mumbai, theatre is language, and this language is shifting. So did you know the biggest 21st century crisis is half of the 6,000 languages which this planet speaks will die. Over 50 languages have only one speaker left. If you are listening to this, you must know one language will vanish from this planet in the next 1 month, never to be found again. Simply because many languages have never been written down, more so in our country. Many languages cannot be read, they never have been. This is a shame. So many stories waiting to be told, these languages are preserved through the theatre. Theatre as a kind of living museum that preserves words. That's why I love the theatre. That's also one of the reasons why I love theatre in this city. Mumbai is a living museum of living words. Cotton 56, polyester 84. The other thing that I discovered was the simplicity of theatre in this city. And the fact that theatre springs up in the most unlikely of venues. From maidans like the Jamboree Maidan, which hosted the month-long Kamgar Festival, the oldest theatre festival in this city, formed in 1939. 5,000 shows have been performed by mill workers from Lower Parel and Naigaon. In the good old days of working class solidarity, the plays were performed in the compound of chawls or in Ganpati mandals. The shows were mainly mythological productions with artificial ornaments and gaudy costumes. The pubs and the audiences contributed to the noble cause. The working class and humble middle class provided a backbone to theatre in this city. Premanand Gajvi, the Bodhi Buddhist playwright, was a BPT employee. Binda Karandikar taught English in a city college. Vijay Tendulkar was a newspaper scribe. BST employees and bank clerks enacted their plays. They were as important to our ecosystem as cricketers and movie actors on the Seven Islands. Why? Because these people wove magic with words. Perhaps the times and the narratives were easier. It was the playwright's theatre and the pen was the Badsha. Then there was the director's theatre which introduced new forms, new ways of expressing content. And then there was the actor's theatre. Today the times belong to the audience's theatre. The only problem is we can't seem to get the audience into the auditorium, or at least the right kind of auditorium, or right kind of audience. This is what I told Meena Menon and Neera Adarkar. As some of you know, Meena and Neera penned a book called 100 Years, 100 Voices. Comrade Meena Menon wanted to organize readings from the book. I told her, comrade, I would prefer to write a play. Fortunately, Sunil Shanbhag agreed to be part of the process. He was willing to direct the play. That's how Cotton 56, Polyester 84 was staged. So the play is basically staging the rise and rise of the cotton mills during the period 1956 to 1984. It looks at the sort of the left being in their sort of glory, then the decline of the left, the arrival of the Shiv Sena, then the arrival of the militant trade unionism that was there, the mafia, and then finally how the mafia controls real estate in the city. So it is that particular period. The play, the title is also a metaphor for what happened in Mumbai, is that these two characters, Bhausaheb and Mia, they are playing a game where, because they are unemployed and out of work, they sit in one of the vachanalayas near their chow, and they are playing a game where they are counting the passers-by who are going by. So one of them counts the people who are wearing cotton shirts, and the other person counts the people who are wearing polyester shirts. So, and that is the sort of, you know, little game that they play. Again, you know, back to Beckett. So that's how Cotton 56, Polyester 84 was staged. My research began by attending court hearings in room number 56 of the High Court, Justice Radhakrishnan's courtroom. The lawyers on either side were the who's who in India: Iqbal Chagla, Ghulam Bahanwati, Arun Jaitley, Soni Sorabji, Mukul Rohtogi, Abhishek Singhvi, Kapil Sibal, etc. I mean, no dearth of talent. Great lawyers, even greater performers. The Bombay Environmental Action Group were the petitioners, and the four main individuals who have been working on this were Teesta Setalwar, Gerson Lacuna, Cyrus Guzdar, and Demi Goel. For me, sitting in room number 56 of the High Court was like watching Shantata Court Salwai, or Steinman and the Vander Meinhof gang on trial in one go. For me, the High Court was a wonderful space for great drama. And the best thing is, it is absolutely free of cost. The Vachik Abhinay is superb, and no one ever forgets their lines. It's in room number 56, High Court, that I later discovered the magic of theatre. As I saw it, the new world order has hypnotized an entire generation in Mumbai. That is what this play tries to say. Second act. A playwright. Are we okay on time? Oh, okay, fine. A playwright, any playwright is the sum total of many plays. There was a phase in my life when I watched plays non-stop. Sometimes the same plays, twice, thrice. And then in my brain cells, I would stage them again. Sometimes, quite interestingly, these plays would talk to each other, have a dialogue, provide a cue, do encores. I recall the first time Cyrus Mistry's Dungaji House talking to Naushad Mehta's Patra Mitra. A Parsi building in Kolaba, exchanging letters about Gujarati language, Gujarati literature, Gujarati culture, and above all, Vile Pahare. Then there was Uttam Gada's Maharati, having a guftagu with Shafat Khan's Shobha Yatra, even before that play was born at the August Kranti Maidan on the 50th anniversary of India's Independence Day. And then there was Jayant Pawar's Adhantar, which was very upset with Sai Paran's Pay Sakit Se Zare, or One Room Kitchen to Sambhuja Talit or Patate Te Chalat. Adhantar argued that even though Adhantar argued with the others, even though it was oft told to shut up, since it was not as senior as the other plays. Upen Kakkar's Mojila Manilal told Adhantar, "Don't mind, please don't be quiet. We plays do not have a class, caste, and creed." So Mojila Manilal and Adhantar went for a walk. They purchased Save Mumra and became best friends. Yes, ladies and gentlemen, Lalbagh and Kalbadevi smoked BDs happily ever after. In all this, there was one play which did not talk to anyone. Like Little Jack Horner, it sat in the corner. It was Vijay Tendulkar's Gidhade. Vultures, Gidhade. Horrid things, vultures, Gidhade. Not nice, nor adorable, simply reprehensible. Petty-minded beasts squabbling and squawking at stinking carcass, willing to attack each other over decomposing meat. Vultures, Gidhade. Carrion eaters with beady, twisted eyes, undernourished, greedy, crooked beaks, often covered in blood and gore, and guts and bloody eyeballs. Also revolting. Vultures, Gidhade. Therefore, most people would prefer to keep a distance from them. But Tendulkar Saab didn't. He placed them on the stage right inside our living rooms. The play was penned in 1961, and it was finally staged in 1970. The vultures were Ramakant and Umakant with their lasciviousness and viciousness, plus their sister Manik's vulgar sensuality. Tendulkar Saab made a link between vultures and the veneer of morality that prevailed in middle-class Maharashtra. He preempted. He knew. A warped sense of domestic violence and how Manik copes with her desires and her family. A bit like Sakharam Binder, another play which simmered and shimmered and scowled in sullen silence. A play due to which Tendulkar Saab became officially associated with sensationalism, sex and violence. Most of Maharashtra was stunned by the wanton display of illicit sex. Today, Tendulkar's Ghashiram Kotwal is an official text, so is Jayant Pawar's Adhantar. Likewise, Me Nathuram Godse Bolto Hai by Pradeep Dalvi and Yada Kadachit by Santosh Pawar, all playing to full houses now. All taboo plays then. So, has Mumbai been gentrified? To find the answer, you have to watch many more plays. And then listen to how these plays gossip with each other in the middle of the night. Because plays are creatures of the underworld, shadows of the low life, and that's the best part about plays in this city. Please note, this is not a nostalgia piece about the rollicking days of theatre. Last year, I judged the final round of a youth one-act play competition, and last week, the Lok Satta one-act play competition concluded. In all, more than 350 groups from all over Maharashtra. The numbers are staggering. They speak of Make in India, we speak of one-act plays being made in Mumbai. One-act suits the Mumbai attitude, short to the point and can be staged anywhere, anytime. This is the one reason why Badal Babu, Badal Sarkar and his one-acts make him the most performed playwright among Mumbai's one-act theatre wadas. But the moment I cherished the most was during a Ramlila show at Azad Maidan. It was the Ashok Vand scene. The group decided that instead of a painted backdrop, they will use a real tree. However, they decided to use the branch of a mango tree since a mango tree was available instead of Ashoka tree. This was placed above Sita Ma in Ravan's garden. Halfway through the scene, the prop manager realized that the mango branch was not working. Not working is a very common phrase in theater. So they added real mangoes to the branch. Even so, they felt the theatrical illusion was faulty. So they added all of Ravan's favorite fruits, bananas, grapes, apples, guava, watermelon, etc. onto the tree. Later, when I went back to see the show, the branch took on a life of its own and assortments from a Coke can to a Center Fresh wrapper was added. All this in the name of Lord Ravan. And that's the magic of theatre in Mumbai, always has been. Shakespeare and She, the epilogue. I read Tempest the other day, and three quick insights. The white colonizers arrive on an island. On that island lives Caliban. The white colonizers treat Caliban like a native and call Caliban's language vernacular.